Hare Krishna, we continue with chapter 6 of Bhagavad Gita, Dhyana Yoga. In chapter 4, Krishna described different types of sacrifices that lead to spiritual advancement. One of them was the process of meditation, Dhyana Yoga, which aims at attaining the super soul. This is the topic of this 6th chapter. One who realizes his spiritual nature often thinks himself as identical with everything else. This is called impersonalism, or Mayavad. When he deepens his knowledge, he understands that there are actually two different categories of living beings: Vibhu, the supreme soul or the super soul, and Anu, the individual soul. The super soul is the master and the individual soul is the servant. In chapter 6, it is clearly stated that the super soul is an expansion of Krishna, and one who directs his service toward him is the best yogi. In chapter 5, Krishna explained how to achieve liberation through work in knowledge and detachment, Naishkarmya. And at the end of the chapter, he explained how to achieve that same liberation through mystic yoga, Ashtanga yoga. This was explained very briefly. Now, in chapter 6, Krishna will connect Naishkarmya with Ashtanga yoga and will describe the process of Ashtanga yoga in greater detail. Ashtanga yoga, a mechanical meditative practice, controls the mind and the senses and focuses concentration on Paramatma. This practice culminates in Samadhi, full consciousness of the Supreme. Detached work and mystic yoga. In the opening of this chapter, Krishna says that one who is unattached to the fruits of his work and who works as he is obliged is in the renounced order of life, and he is the true mystic, not he who lights no fire and performs no duty. In other words, Krishna again warns that one should not give up work prematurely. Real renunciation means to renounce the fruit of work and the desire for sense enjoyment while still working dutifully. One may give up work only after sufficient purification through detached work, Naishkarmya. Thus, in order to attain his goal, the Ashtanga yogi should perform activities which are not directly connected to his yoga practice. First, he has to adopt the process of detached work in order to purify his consciousness from material desires, which will hamper his attempt to exclusive meditation. One cannot just sit and meditate all day long unless he is very advanced. So we can try to do this. We can try to sit comfortably in our home and try to meditate for, let's say, 10 minutes. Okay? 10 minutes only. Now, imagine that this is all that you should do all day and night. The yogis do not sleep much. Imagine that your only allowed recreation or fun is to occasionally go for a walk. And not only that, we kind of misled you. It is not actually allowed to practice this type of meditation at home. So you should not actually sit at home. You cannot sit at home and meditate according to the Ashtanga yoga practice. You have to leave home, your sweet home, for good, and go to a holy place in some, let's say, some mountain, in some cave, and live there alone. Girlfriends, boyfriends are strictly forbidden from this practice. The point here is that one cannot just start practicing Ashtanga yoga. There is a long period of preparation by working in knowledge and detachment. On the other hand, a bhakti yogi, devotee of Krishna, achieves perfection by devotional service alone, without the need of separate endeavors. This is because bhakti, as the topmost yoga practice, is independent and awards the results of all other yoga systems. This is the unique feature of bhakti yoga. Those who are already executing their work for the satisfaction of Lord Krishna are not required to separately perform sacrifices, austerities, or meditation, which are not on the platform of pure Krishna consciousness. The pure devotee of Krishna is automatically a brahmana, sannyasi, and a yogi. Like a karmi or a fruitive worker, he is expert in performing sacrifices and executing his duties. like a jnani or a seeker of knowledge. He is renounced and austere and knowledgeable. And like a yogi, he is also detached from the fruits of his work and has brought his senses under control so that he can meditate. One who is completely detached from all fruitive work and has become attracted to the Supreme Lord and his loving devotional service is simultaneously ornamented with all good qualities. Another implication of Krishna's statement is that one should strive for proper activity as well as the proper mood behind it. A person who is attached only to the external designations is called a pretender. On the other hand, a great soul who is in perfect consciousness is not dependent on the external situation, although he may decide to follow the rules in order to set a good example. He knows that sannyasa or jnana and yoga are the same, because they both involve renunciation of desire for sense enjoyment. So, as we already explained, even an Ashtanga yogi must perform naishkarmya, or detached work, in the beginning of his practice. By detached work, he becomes qualified to renounce the work. There are two levels in Ashtanga yoga, the neophyte stage and the advanced stage. In the neophyte stage, one performs naishkarmya and practices Ashtanga yoga at the same time. When he becomes steady in his meditation, he may give up work and engage in Ashtanga yoga exclusively. For the practitioner of Ashtanga yoga who desires to attain the advanced stage of steadiness in meditation, prescribed duties are the cause of his elevation to that stage, since they purify the heart. For one who has already attained the advanced stage, characterized by steadiness in meditation, cessation of those prescribed duties is the cause of maintaining such steadiness, because performance of prescribed duties is destructive. It interrupts his meditation. The advanced stage begins when, having renounced all material desires, the yogi neither acts for sense gratification nor engages in fruitive activities. In order to attain this advanced stage of yoga, one should learn how to control the mind. One should deliver himself from the material bondage with the help of his mind and not degrade himself. The mind is both a friend and an enemy of the conditioned soul. For one who has conquered the mind is the best of friends. But for one who has failed to do so, the mind remains the greatest enemy. What is the meaning of this? The uncontrolled mind is an enemy of the conditioned soul because it is addicted to material sense gratification, and this is harmful. Though it feels natural and firm, sense gratification is actually detrimental and brings countless miseries. The purpose of the yoga system is to control the mind and to draw it away from attachment to sense objects. This should be done gradually. Just like an expert horseman desiring to tame a headstrong horse first lets the horse have his way for a moment and then, pulling the reins, gradually places the horse on the desired path. Similarly, the expert yogi first carefully observes the movements and desires of the mind and gradually brings them under full control. The mind must be so trained that it can deliver the conditioned soul from the world of nations. It is actually the state of our mind at the moment of death which determines the quality of our next birth. In material existence, one is subjected to the influence of the mind and the senses. Therefore, the mind should be trained so that it is not attracted by the glitter of the material nature, and the mind should be attracted to Krishna. The more one is attracted by sense objects, the more one becomes entangled in material existence. The best way to disentangle oneself is to have positive engagement in spiritual activities, in Krishna consciousness. In order to make the mind our friend, we require a good association. The best association is a sadhu, a saintly person, pure devotee of Krishna. With his instructions, the saintly person, he can cut our attachment to material association. To cut something a sharp instrument is required, and to cut the mind from its attachments, sharp words are often required. So the sadhu or teacher shows no mercy in using sharp words to cut the student's mind from material attractions. By speaking the truth uncompromisingly, he's able to accomplish this. And we see this in Bhagavad Gita. For example, in the very beginning of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna spoke very sharply to Arjuna by telling him that although he speaks like a learned man, he's actually fool number one. If we actually want detachment from this material world, we should be prepared to accept such cutting words from our spiritual master. Compromise and flattery have no effect where strong words are required. This is a very important point because in our contemporary society, the cutting words of the saintly person are often designated as intolerant, hate speech. This is similar to revolt against the correct diagnosis of a qualified physician as being a discriminative act of oppression or hatred. It sounds foolish, but that's what it is. The result of this is that the society is plunged in deeper and deeper ignorance. Shunning the guidance of the saintly persons, people are left on their own, which means that they are fully controlled by their mind and senses, with no higher purpose than sense gratification, just like animals. This is a symptom of animal society. In such a society, the practice of so-called yoga and spirituality is simply a farce. It will never allow the practitioners to attain the advanced stages of yoga. What are the symptoms of a yogi who has achieved such advanced stage? For one who has conquered the mind, the super soul is already reached because he has attained tranquility. Such a person, Krishna explains, is above the dualities of the material world. The mind must admit some superior dictation and follow it. The effect of controlling the mind is that one automatically follows the dictation of the Paramatma, or super soul, the Lord in the heart. There are two levels of the advanced stage of yoga. On the first level, a yogi is fully satisfied by virtue of acquiring knowledge, of the acquired knowledge and realization. Therefore, he sees everything, pebbles or gold, as the same. Such a yogi is not attracted to the material energy and sees all kinds of objects meant for sense pleasure as garbage on the street. As we mentioned, such realization cannot be reached by mental speculation or mundane scholarship. One must be fortunate enough to associate with a person who is in pure consciousness. And by pleasing and serving such person, he will attain this level. A yogi is considered even more advanced when he regards honest well-wishers, affectionate benefactors, the neutral mediators, the envious, the friends and the enemies, the pious and the sinners, all with equal mind, treating everyone as part and parcel of Krishna. This is possible when one realizes that all material dualities like friend and enemy, saint and sinner are just like roles in a drama. On stage, one may say, oh, you are my enemy, I shall kill you, and so on. But when off stage, we are all friends because we are all children of God. Having described the advanced stage of yoga, Krishna now explains how to practice yoga in that advanced stage. The yogi must concentrate the mind by remaining in seclusion and avoiding disturbance from external objects. All these rules are perfectly executed in Bhakti Yoga. A Krishna conscious person knows well that everything belongs to Krishna, and thus he is always free from feelings of personal possession. He has no hankering for anything on his personal account, because he is perfectly satisfied. He knows how to accept things in favor of Krishna consciousness and how to reject things unfavorable to Krishna consciousness. He's always aloof from material things because he's always transcendental. And he's always alone, having nothing to do with persons not in Krishna consciousness. Therefore, a person in Krishna consciousness is the perfect yogi. He's always alone. That means that he always keeps the association of devotees. He only associates with saintly people. We are very much dependent on our association. If we associate with spiritually inclined people, we will advance spiritually. And if we associate with materialistic people, we will become gradually contaminated. Therefore, a devotee, he always associates with devotees. Therefore, Mahaprabhu defines a devotee as Asat Sanga Tyaga E Vaishnava Chara. Devotee is, Vaishnava is the person who avoids, who rejects the association of non-devotees. So in this section, Krishna gives strict rules and regulations for focusing the mind on the super soul. The yogi must be devoid of sex life and fear, because these are obstacles for advancement. One has to practice controlling the mind and avoiding all kinds of sense gratification, of which sex life is the chief. No one is able to perform yoga through sex indulgence. So, therefore, brahmacharya or celibacy is taught from the childhood, when one has no knowledge of sex life. Without such practice of a brahmacharya, no one can make advancement in any yoga, whether it is dhyana, jnana, or bhakti. One who, however, follows the rules and regulations of married life, having a sexual relationship only with his wife, and this is also under regulation for begetting children, not for recreation, not for fun, he's also called the brahmachari. Such a restrained householder, brahmachari, may be accepted in the bhakti school. But the jnana and the dhyana schools do not even admit householder brahmacharis. They require complete abstinence from sex life without compromise. In the bhakti school, a householder brahmachari is allowed to control sex life because the cult of bhakti yoga is so powerful that one automatically loses sexual attraction, being engaged in the superior service of the Lord. Therefore, if a devotee householder is still attracted to sexual pleasure and breaks the rules and regulations of bhakti, he is not in this category of householder brahmachari. The goal of Ashtanga Yoga is Paramatma realization. Krishna declares that in order to realize this goal, the yogi must include bhakti in his practice. Thus, the processes of karma, jnana, or Ashtanga Yoga cannot award the desired success unless they have some connection with bhakti. Therefore, only bhakti is an independent process for spiritual advancement. Following all these rules and regulations for control of body, mind, and activities, the yogi attains the abode of Krishna by cessation of material existence. The Lord warns, however, that some additional obstacles for the aspiring yogi are to be considered. The yogi should be regulated in eating, sleeping, recreation, and work. In this way, he will be freed from material miseries by practicing yoga. The advanced yogi is regulated in his mental activities and is situated in transcendence. He is not dependent on the dictations of his mind. Rather, the mind has become under his control. Nor is his mind turned off or extinguished, because it is the yogi's duty to think always of Krishna. Such an advanced yogi is devoid of material desires. Actually, it is not possible to become desireless without desires. The desire for sanctification must be overcome, but the desire for service to Krishna should be cultivated. A yogi who is free of material desires is always steady in his meditation on Paramatma. In order to become steady and determined, a yogi should practice brahmacharya, as we already explained. When the a candle is in a windless place, its flame remains straight and does not waver. The mind is like the flame, and it is susceptible to so many material desires that with the slightest agitation it will move, and a little movement of the mind can change the whole consciousness. Therefore, in India, one seriously practicing yoga traditionally remains brahmachari or celibate. Next, Krishna describes the samadhi reached by such an advanced yogi. established in boundless happiness. The yogi never departs from the truth because he is convinced that nothing greater can be gained. A bhakti yogi is the perfect example for this. A Krishna conscious person is so happy in his occupation, so blissful, so fully satisfied that he does not aspire after any other happiness. The stage of samadhi awards the yogi with the 8 mystic perfections which allow him to manipulate matter in miraculous ways. But in samadhi, the yogi regards all these mystic perfections as insignificant. Usually, however, they are very alluring for many less fortunate yogis, and because of them, these less fortunate yogis deviate from their practice and try to use these mystic powers in order to impress the ordinary people. Such yogis are victim of the archetypal desires of the conditioned soul, to be the controller, the enjoyer, and the best friend of all. On the other hand, for the devotee of the Lord, there is no such danger, because his heart and his concentration are fixed on his goal, because he always works for the pleasure of Lord Krishna. He is always in samadhi, such a devotee. So how to achieve this level of samadhi? One should practice yoga with determination and faith and not deviate. One should be sure of success at the end and should follow this path with great determination, and should not become discouraged if there is any delay of the attainment of success, because success is sure for the rigid practitioner by the mercy of Krishna. Srila Prabhupada explains, the practice of yoga, especially the practice of bhakti yoga in Krishna consciousness, may appear to be a very difficult job, but if anyone follows the principles with great determination, the Lord will surely help, for God helps those who help themselves. Such determination results from strong faith in the process of bhakti yoga. So a yogi should be firmly convinced that real happiness is transcendental to material sensual experience. Unless he is convinced of this, he will surely be agitated and will fall down. He should know, in other words, that his goal, his aspirations are much higher than anything the material world can offer. And then, if he is convinced about this, he will be very steady. With such strong faith and determination, he should give up all material desires, born of mental speculation, and thus control the senses by the mind. And gradually, step by step, one should bring the mind back under the control of the self. The yogi should have his mind trained in such a way that as soon as his mind wanders from meditation on Krishna, he should immediately drag it back again to Krishna. This requires a great deal of practice, of course. One must come to know that his real happiness, as we mentioned, is in spiritual things, not in material things. So what are the symptoms of such a perfect yogi? The yogi whose mind is fixed on Krishna attains the highest perfection of transcendental happiness. He is freed from all reactions of previous activities, he is beyond the mode of passion, and he realizes that he is qualitatively one with the Supersoul. Understanding that Krishna and the Supersoul are one, the yogi can progress toward personal relationships with the Lord. So the vision of the perfect yogi has two aspects. He sees Krishna in all beings and sees every being in Krishna. Although he sees Krishna in everything, he does not think that everything has become Krishna. He is not, in other words, a mayavadi. The yogi rather sees the Lord in the heart of every living entity. And the advanced yogi sees also that all living beings are energy of the Lord and are situated in the energy of the Lord, the material or the spiritual world. For such a person, for such a yogi, Krishna is never lost and he is never lost to Krishna. Only on the basis of such an intimate relationship with the Lord, it is possible to develop universal, all-encompassing love for all creatures, for all living beings. For example, when a devotee sees a cow or a dog, he knows that they are part and parcel of Krishna, even though they have a different body. The difference in bodies does not mean that they are not his brothers. If we love Krishna, we will love all his creations without exception. There cannot be any real love without loving God. So such a yogi who engages in the service of the Supersoul, understanding that Krishna and the Supersoul are one, remains always in Krishna consciousness in all circumstances. A perfect yogi is he who sees in both, who sees that in both their happiness and their distress, all beings are originally equal. In other words, he sees that what is good for himself and what is bad for himself are equally applicable for all other living beings. Therefore, he has compassion in his heart. He desires happiness for all others and does not desire suffering for anyone. And this is the most important type of equal vision for one, for a yogi. And the yogi who has attained this equal vision is considered the best yogi. Out of compassion, such a yogi preaches the message of God for the benefit of all conditioned souls. Here, there is a contrast between a pure devotee of the Lord and a yogi interested only in his personal elevation. The yogi who has withdrawn to a secluded place in order to meditate is not as perfect as the devotee who is trying his best to help everybody by giving them transcendental knowledge. In the beginning of this chapter, Krishna explained that the beginner Ashtanga yogi should practice detached work until he attains the advanced level of yoga. At this advanced stage, he can give up work and engage only in yoga practice. In the above section, the Lord described the practice of Ashtanga yoga in detail. A yogi should leave home and go to a secluded place, stay there alone and engage in severe austerities and rigorous meditation. After a long practice, he can realize the Supersoul and achieve the same liberation in the Supreme, which has been already described in chapter 5. So, after hearing about these difficult practices, Arjuna declares himself unfit for Ashtanga Yoga. Leaving home and going to a cave up in the mountain to meditate and live alone there? No way. This is simply impossible. So Arjuna's reaction was very similar to this. Arjuna said that the system of yoga that Krishna has summarized appears impractical and unendurable for him because the mind is restless and unsteady. Arjuna said that the mind is turbulent, obstinate, and very strong, and to subdue the mind is more difficult than to control the wind. Arjuna rejects Ashtanga Yoga particularly because he finds it impossible to be impartial toward friends and enemies. Sometimes there will be equal treatment of friends and neutral persons. That is possible, he argues, but never of enemies or those who criticize. You cannot treat these people equally like your friends. Even if one is able to see that the Lord is situated in the heart of everyone without making distinctions, this state cannot be permanent because the strong, fickle mind cannot keep that discrimination for long. So Arjuna has a point. The practice of Ashtanga Yoga is not practical for this age of Kali. It is not possible for an ordinary man to leave home and go to a secluded place in the mountains or in jungles to practice yoga all day and night. The present age, as we know, is characterized by a bitter struggle for life, as Srila Prabhupada explains. Struggle for existence, and the life is very short. People are not serious about self-realization, even by simple practical means. What to speak of this difficult yoga system, which regulates the mode of living, the manner of sitting, selection of place, and detachment of the mind from material engagements, etc. As a practical man, Arjuna thought it was impossible to follow this system of yoga, even though he was a very great personality, much greater than the regular Kali Yuga fellow. He belonged to the royal family and was highly elevated in terms of numerous different qualities, Srila Prabhupada explains. He was a great warrior, he had great longevity, and above all, he was the most intimate friend of Lord Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Still, he said that this practice of yoga is impossible for him. Therefore, this system must be considered generally impossible in this age of Kali. Is there any yoga system which is possible in our day and age? Yes, the best way to practice yoga in Kali Yuga is to chant the Maha Mantra Hare Krishna in a humble mood. Why is this? Because this transcendental sound vibration is not different from Krishna. When we chant His name with devotion, then Krishna is with us. And when Krishna is with us, then what is the possibility of remaining impure? Consequently, one absorbed in Krishna consciousness, in chanting the names of Krishna and serving Him always, receives the benefit of the highest form of yoga. Then the advantage is that he doesn't have to take all the trouble of the meditation process. This is the beauty of Krishna consciousness. The mind and the senses can be controlled only when they are fully engaged in service of Krishna. Thus, for one whose mind is unbridled, self-realization is difficult. But for one who controls the mind and strives by appropriate means, Krishna consciousness, it is possible to attain success. Considering himself unable to succeed in the practice of Ashtanga Yoga, Arjuna is worried that he will be a failure both materially and spiritually. The unsuccessful yogi does not enjoy material happiness, nor he attains spiritual bliss. Does such a person have any position? Arjuna asks. Or like a small cloud that has broken away from a big cloud, he just disintegrates. With this question, Arjuna reveals a fundamental doubt of the conditioned soul. The conditioned soul generally does not truly believe in the existence of the spiritual world. Even when he has some faith, he is afraid to give up the shelter of his materialistic activities because he does not believe in the protection of the Lord. Such a person has more faith in the material values than in the injunctions of Shastra. He is compared to one who dreams that he is awake. The conditioned soul needs a strong affirmation that he will not lose from his attempt to surrender to the Lord. He must be reassured by the Lord that even if he falls from his spiritual path, he will be ultimately benefited. So hearing Arjuna's doubt, Krishna's heart melts with compassion. He assures Arjuna that a yogi who is engaged in transcendental activities will never meet with destruction anywhere because one who does good is never overcome by evil. The unsuccessful yogi does not perish like a riven cloud, but what exactly happens to him? After many years of enjoyment on the higher planets, he again takes birth into a rich or pious family, or in a family of transcendentalists who are advanced in Krishna consciousness. The latter birth is very rare in this world. After taking an elevated birth, the yogi revives his divine consciousness and strives to achieve complete success. In this life, even without seeking, he automatically becomes attracted to yoga. Such a person always stands above the ritualistic principles of scripture because he has already attained the goal of such rituals by becoming spontaneously attached to yoga. Being washed of all contaminations after many, many births, he attains the supreme goal. The yogi is the best of all transcendentalists, and the devotee of Krishna is the topmost yogi. Krishna says that the yogi is greater than the fruitive worker, greater than the speculative philosopher, the jnani, and greater than the ascetic. Therefore, Arjuna is advised to be a yogi in all circumstances. The fruitive workers cannot be counted among the yogis. The actual yogis are the karma yogis, the jnana yogis, the ashtanga yogis, and the bhakti yogis. Factually, Srila Prabhupada explains, they are the same, although named differently. The yogic process is like a ladder one ascends gradually toward the final goal of the absolute truth. Nishkama karma, or renunciation of the fruits of one's labor, is the first step of this ladder. When knowledge and austerity are added to this, it becomes jnana yoga, the second step. And when meditation on the Supreme is added to the jnana yoga, the third step is reached, namely Ashtanga Yoga. Finally, when loving devotional service to the Supreme Lord is practiced along with Ashtanga Yoga, it is transformed into Bhakti Yoga. This entire successive process is called Yoga. For an exact and clear delineation of the subject of Yoga, all four steps need to be explained separately. Those who desire the best for humanity take to the path of Yoga. The process for progressing in Yoga requires first determination and strict execution of discipline at this stage. When a person is firmly situated At one stage, he then has to relinquish attachment and adherence to the practices of that stage in order to elevate himself to the next higher stage. Those who cannot reach the top for some reason and get stuck at any one of the four stages, of the three stages, actually, acquire the designations of that particular stage. Thus, there are karma yogis, jnana yogis, ashtanga yogis, and there are also bhakta yogis. The Lord instructs Arjuna that one who renders loving devotional service to Him, the Supreme Lord, is the highest among all yogis, and that Arjuna should thus strive to become such a bhakti yogi. The yogis are the best among all transcendentalists because they realize the super soul. Of all the yogis, one who with great faith always abides in Krishna, thinks of Krishna within himself and renders transcendental loving service to Krishna is the most intimately united with Krishna in yoga and is the highest of all. This is Krishna's opinion. Thus, the culmination of all kinds of yoga practices lies in bhakti yoga. All other yogas are but means to come to the point of bhakti in bhakti yoga. Yoga actually means bhakti yoga, Srila Prabhupada explains. All other yogas are progressions toward the destination of bhakti yoga. Factually, bhakti yoga is the ultimate goal, but to analyze bhakti yoga minutely, one has to understand these other yogas. Now we are going to summarize the first six chapters of Bhagavad Gita. In the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna becomes depressed and refuses to fight due to family attachment. In the beginning of the second chapter, Arjuna surrenders to Krishna and begs for guidance. To remove Arjuna's illusion, Krishna explains the eternal nature of the soul. Arjuna should not feel miserable for his relatives because nobody will ever die. Since Arjuna's lamentation is still not dispelled, the Lord gives the method by which the soul can be realized, and this method is working knowledge or naishkarmya. And Krishna also describes the characteristics of the self-realized person. In the beginning of the third chapter, Arjuna is confused because he misunderstood that acquiring transcendental knowledge is incompatible with work. To eradicate this mistake, Krishna explains naishkarmya or buddhi yoga as work combined with knowledge. Krishna does this again. Such detached work is a sacrifice and it is the means of attaining transcendental realization. Even great self-realized persons perform this work in order to set a good example for others. The Lord emphasizes that in order to perform naishkarmya steadily, one should conquer lust and thus overcome material dualities. In the third chapter, it is explained that naishkarmya culminates in transcendental knowledge. In the fourth chapter, the Lord glorifies transcendental knowledge as the goal of all different types of sacrifices. Krishna gives the essence of the transcendental knowledge by revealing the cause of his appearance and the transcendental nature of his pastimes. So this is the essence of transcendental knowledge. The essence is knowledge of Bhagavan Krishna. The direct method for attaining this knowledge is to surrender to a self-realized soul, pure devotee of the Lord. By his mercy, one can attain not only knowledge about soul and matter, but full realization of the source of both, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Arjuna, however, is still confused because he did not understand that work in full knowledge is non-reactive and is therefore the same as inaction. As a result, in the beginning of fifth chapter, he asks which is more beneficial, work or renunciation of work. Krishna explains that though they are equal, work in knowledge is better than renunciation of work because it is easier and safer. Such activity leads to liberation because it is performed without selfish desires for the pleasure of the Lord. On the other hand, dry renunciation brings frustration because it is unnatural for the soul. Therefore, working knowledge can be replaced with renunciation only after sufficient purification by detached work. Although even then, the majority of the self-realized persons continue to perform their duties in order to give a good example for the common man. By dovetailing all activities with the Supreme, one realizes that Krishna is the Supreme Enjoyer, Controller, and the best friend of all living entities. Then he attained peace. Sixth chapter describes how one can attain self-realization by the method of Ashtanga Yoga. As with Jnana Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga is suitable for a person who has been purified by Karma Yoga. A devotee of the Lord, a Bhakti Yogi, automatically performs the essence and attains the goal of all other yoga processes. Thus, the Ashtanga Yogi is the best of all transcendentalists, and the devotee of Krishna, the Bhakti Yogi, is the topmost among all yogis. So, in the first six chapters of Bhagavad Gita, the living entity has been described as non-material spirit soul, capable of elevating himself to self-realization by different types of yogas. At the end of the sixth chapter, it has been clearly stated that the steady concentration of the mind upon Krishna, or in other words, Krishna consciousness, is the highest form of all yoga. Different types of yoga are only stepping stones on the path of Krishna consciousness. By practice of Krishna conscious yoga, one can know everything in full, namely the absolute truth, the living entities, the material nature, and their manifestation with their paraphernalia. In the last verse of sixth chapter, the Lord introduces Bhakti Yoga, the yoga of devotion, which will be described in detail in the middle six chapters.